Hello, people who are watching this on YouTube well after the fact. It's the more I think about it, the more I'm like, the first little bit, that's for our YouTube folks because no one's joined yet because we're only just going live.
It's true.
Greetings, YouTube.
Yeah,
shout out to people can watch on Twitch later too. Let's not forget, we love Twitch watchers after.
Oh, absolutely. I'm just saying, like, those first like 30 seconds, minute and a half, like no one's gotten logged in just yet, 'cause we got
I haven't even
a
logged in
mascot.
yet, and I had it open, but I have to mute
Oh
there.
no, it still says Brandon's doing stuff. I must fix it.
It does. It
But
said Brandon is live.
yeah, I thought that StreamYards would not do that, but it did. And now I'm like, dang it. So I will pop into OBS and fix that. How has everyone's month been?
Not good. How about
Been busy. A challenging spring. A spring of challenges.
That's a good way to say it. Actually, the D&D game was great. I think that was the highlight of my whole month.
Nice. Lauren, we had a event that was in person for the first time since last year. Last month.
Oh, that's so
So
exciting.
assembled en masse to nerd out collectively. Always nice.
Yeah, it was great.
Such a good time.
One exciting piece of book news. The Hugo award finalists, like the nominees, were announced.
Ooh.
I'm a big like follower of the Hugo Awards in a way that I don't follow anything else. The Oscars, National Book Award, nothing. I'm just like, I'm here for the sci-fi and fantasy.
Very beautifully on brand for you, though. So, like, yes,
I
wonderful.
will also say you have come to book club and been like, so this was a Hugo Award winner, and I'm putting it up for nomination. And then we read it, and it's like, well, no wonder it
Yeah.
won. It's so good.
And you've already read one of the five nominees.
Whoa.
Want me to tell you
Well,
hey.
the others?
I'm actually, no, that's great. I don't think it's gonna win, but I'm happy for it. For them. It
Yeah.
should be on the finalist list at least. It's good
So
stuff. Yeah.
we've got A Desolation Called Peace by Arkady Martine, The Galaxy and the Ground Within by all of our favorites, Becky Chambers,
Oh, yay.
The Light from Uncommon Stars by Rika Aoki, A Master of Gin by P. Djeli Clark, one of my favorite reads from last year, and Project Hail Mary, and She Became the Sun by Shelley Parker Chan.
That one sounds familiar. I feel like
Did we have that on the nomination list or something similar?
I might have recommended it before. In fact, my write-up with for recommendations is three of the ones on the list that I haven't read. No, two of the ones I haven't read, and then Master of Gin, because I liked it a lot. So yeah.
I think that's a
Love
lovely
Becoming
idea
the
for future book clubs is to just be like, we should read the Hugo nominees.
I did that
I
one year. It was really good, except some of them are sequels. That's why I didn't read all of them last year. I was like, I can't catch up in
Yeah.
this like three novel series. It was too much, but could knock a couple more out.
Well, I was thinking Master of Gin, didn't we read the prequel to that tram
We did.
car? Was it 15?
Yeah, I think so.
I struggled to recall the number of the tram car.
I think it was either tram. I think it was tram car 15.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I've got Master of Jin over there. It's waiting.
Yeah,
like so many other books over there. It's
well, and-
so we've read the prequel to one of the nominees. We've read the other nominee, and we've read multiple Becky Chambers books. We're like in it.
We're so cool.
We are clearly an in-touch book group. All right. I think, let's see. Let me just double check. Yeah, I think we're good to start getting into this, because I know Sharon's got a lot of thoughts. I know I have a fair few thoughts. Marion, just based on the spoiler text in the book club chat, I know you've got quite a few thoughts. So let's start off base level. How did everyone like the book?
I enjoyed it. Did I always like the main character? No, but I found it impossible to put down. I was very entertained.
I will second all of the things that Lauren said. My journey was different, but those main points are the same.
I also really liked it. I loved it until like the last 75 to 100. I don't know exactly when, but there was a point where I was like, okay, I kind of know what's happening now. I know who's going to live that I wanted to live. And I'm good. And I do want to know the ending, but I'm not like, I can't put it down anymore. Like the first few hundred pages, I was really gripped and entertained 100%. And then that last bit, I was kind of like, well, you know, I'm not as invested in the character. Rocky is going to be all right. That's really all I cared about by that point of the book. overall, yeah. Probably 4 before. I don't think we're to that point yet, but you know, 4 out of 5 probably. Yeah.
Mine was kind of flipped. I was like thoroughly irritated the majority of the first part of the book. And then I was like, oh, I get it now. Ah. And then it was like a vicious like hate read from then on. I was like, ha.
I overall very much enjoyed the story. I too struggled with Ryland Grace as a character very frequently, especially when he is pulling the Arthur Dent nonsense where he's like, well, I can't be a hero. I am a scientist. I have school children to teach. It's like, get out there and save humanity, damn it. Come on.
Right. And one of the things I keep thinking about, like I was talking to you guys earlier and I was saying how some things just bother me more as time goes on. And one of those is how he like left his schoolroom in a fury of, I must save the world for these children. Didn't say goodbye to them. Just walked out of the school to go to the lab. And then like not when it was actually like, okay, you do need to save your kids now. He's like, no, that's okay. I did what I'm gonna do.
Yeah, it was never about the kids. He's just a coward.
Well, and he clearly has like a lot of ego wrapped up in this, which is why like that one scientist comes onto the project and the two of them immediately start arguing, and why like him being part of the project first is really important, and him working on it, even though it's like, okay, well, you said there are other more qualified scientists, so we're going to ship off Astrophage to all of them so that they can work on it. And he's like, well, but can't I keep a little? I feel like I should be able to keep a little. Like, the whole time, it was about the importance of Ryland Grace. And I loathe that as a character, but I love that as a writing choice, because it's so rare that we get to see the hero of our story be just an absolute douchebag.
I agree. The point where I like started to enjoy it more was when we found out that he refused to save Earth. Because before that, I was just like, ugh. Like, I was enjoying the story, but like, I was just like, I'm so over this guy. Everything he encounters, he like succeeds at. He's so like full of himself. Like, and then when both the reader finds it out and he finds it out that he's like a piece of shit that like refused to save Earth, then I was like, oh, okay, the author realizes to a certain extent that he's like kind of insufferable. And then I was like, okay, I'm on board.
I'm not gonna lie, I got the impression that Andy Weir had decided that Ryland Grace was a cowardly POS long before like making the reveal in the book.
Oh, he did, yeah. Any of you read that Goodreads interview that I linked to in the chat? Very interesting. I mean, that's basically what he says. He says his first book, you didn't really know anything about the character, but he liked to do algebra and he was a little bit of a smart ass. So he was like, it was all the best parts about me and none of the bad parts about me. And then the second book was like the opposite. I won't go into that, but I mean, I could understand what he was saying. She wasn't a very entertaining character and she wasn't super likable. In my opinion, but in also a lot of people's opinion, apparently. And then this one, he was like, I never had any character growth. So I really am a terrible writer and I wanted to have some character growth. So yeah, he wanted to have a douchebag character who did something different by the end of the book, basically.
I would like to bring up the fact that Lauren and I made up some questions to discuss today. And one of those questions is, does Ryland Grace have a character arc? Does he show growth in this book? I am here to tell you that the correct answer is no.
It's not an opinion.
It is facts.
Tell me more, but I think I'm actually going to agree with you, but say more.
Yeah. He operates entirely off of attention and risk, like, someone fueling that ego. He is all set.
But there is that one moment where he doesn't have to go save another living creature or their planet. Nobody would care. Nobody would know. He could go back to Earth a hero and never tell them about Rocky and the fact that planet died because he didn't do a thing. So that was the moment that he did sacrifice himself. He thought he was sacrificing himself in order to save a planet.
I don't think that that's actually how he made that choice.
Really?
He made a choice between going to save his friend who worshipped him basically as like one of the smartest beings he knew versus going back to the planet that hated him, tricked him, and sent him off on this mission so they can go screw themselves. He doesn't need to go back there. He doesn't know what's waiting for him. He doesn't know anyone there anymore. But this is a known situation. He knows what he's going to get if he goes after Rocky. Okay. He doesn't know about Earth. So.
Okay. Actually, that makes a lot more sense. I think the writer's intention was probably character growth, but I think you make more sense than he did.
I kind of fall in the middle. Like, I think the author's intent is character growth. And I think like, if you look at the actions that he takes in the book, you're like, ah, yes, character growth. But I don't think he really truly grappled with the selfishness of his previous decision enough to convince me that he's like, understands what it means.
I think he,
to like,
it was an accidental good choice.
I think maybe just because of the writing style or like the focus on like the technical aspects, I never emotionally felt like he had character growth. Even though like, you look at like the sequence of events, you're like, oh yes, he made the correct choice. But I just didn't.
He was put into a circumstance in which his instinct as a douchebag allowed him to make the correct choice, which I thought was very interesting. And like something, Josh, you said something earlier about this being like a very interesting like narrative device. This type of unreliable narrator was so irritating to me at first until he was revealed for what he was as an unreliable narrator. And then I was like, oh, I'm on board. I'm so on board now. Yeah. What's going on?
I guess that I kind of liked him for a long time. I thought he made some questionable decisions and he was a little selfish. But I thought a lot of that was like the brain damage, and I thought it was a lot of the
I thought it was the brain damage.
I'm a scientist who enjoys figuring out problems, but I don't really know anything about what's going on here. So I'm going to just stumble stupidly through a lot of things. And he made a lot of mistakes. Like I didn't see him as like a MacGyver who geniusly did everything right away. It was like, he kind of fucked things up a lot. Sorry. And you know, then they sometimes got back to, it got worked out. But I really enjoyed his smart assness a lot at first. Like when the astrophage disappeared in the lab, when he had done like the little experiments and figured things out, he was like, I figured it out. It was like, shit, they're gone. I really enjoyed that sort of thing. Like, yeah, he's like an idiot and he's not really seeing the whole picture yet. But I did kind of like him because it's really easy to project onto a character you don't know a lot about. And then I don't know, at some point I did start to go, oh wait, he's a little less than bumbling fool genius. He's actually kind of selfish and horrible. And that was gradually revealed enough to me to be very satisfying by the time we knew for sure how selfish he was.
That was the main thing that I was thinking about in like in connection to Goblin Emperor. What's the main character of Goblin Emperor? Whatever
Maya?
His name is.
Maya.
Maya, yeah. Maya was all show and no tell, and Ryland Grace is all tell. He's like, oh, ho, 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 I'm so funny. And did you know that I'm the cool teacher? Ho, ho. And I'm just like, I immediately hate you. I'm so sorry. But,
I think if I had gone back and like read the first part again, because I was like, I loved the science aspects. Like, I thought it was fun. I was here for like the mystery, figure it out aspects. Like, oh, where in the universe am I? Like, like loved it. So for me, it was like the enjoyment of the book was like, oh gosh, it was like spiked. And then like started to peter off kind of in the middle where I was like, ooh. And then it like went back up again when we finally got that like payoff reveal of the unreliable narrator. I was charmed at first. I was enjoying it, and then slowly it started to sour. And I bet if I read back, I would start to see those little crumbs, like when he doesn't have any. He clearly doesn't have any friends.
Excuse me. Continue.
Yeah, yeah. He doesn't have any friends. Like he gets invited to like a party to do like for the viewing of something. Science-y?
Like one of the yeah.
Doesn't go. He's just like a little
loner or something. Yeah, I can't remember what that was. But yeah, there's lots of crumbs.
Yeah, some of the ways he interacts with Strat, who I want to talk about.
Ooh, Strat's cool. Oh, I mean, she's horrible.
She's the real hero of this book.
I love a bitch that gets stuff done, and that is like Strat. To a T, like to 120%.
She's gonna get it done. She doesn't care how. I love it.
I mean,
he said in the interview that it came out of his failed second book. Like he'd written like 90,000 words of a second series, and he was like, it was terrible. It was not good. But this character was one of the things that came out of that book, the person who would do whatever it took to get the job done.
I'm gonna jump into chat real quick. Lost Limey says he gets a retroactive arc, so we see him at the end of his arc in all the non-flashback parts, so he doesn't grow in the narrative. And Yell Jones says, but we do see him from the time he wakes up to the end of the mission, and you could argue that his decision to help Rocky at the end was a result of character growth during that time. I also see the other side, though. I think the big thing for me is that he's still making the biggest ego decision. He's already saved Earth. Now he gets to save Iridian too. Like, I'll be the savior of two planets and they'll hail me as a hero on both. So, you know, that'll be pretty cool. Like, it's nothing has changed. From the beginning to the end, it's been all about Ryland Grace's ego. And I'm not mad about it. I still feel like it's the right decision, but I feel like for the wrong reasons. And the fact that he somehow manages to score a high school teaching job on an alien planet using basically an organ keyboard, I think is just indicative of him being like, yeah, I'll stay where I'm really popular and people like me a lot. That'll be cool. Maybe I'll go back at some point. Maybe, but probably.
I thought it was younger kids. I don't know. Was it high school on the alien planet too? I thought it was like younger kids.
They were like 30 somethings, which my understanding was that those are like.
I thought it was like middle school age, but I don't know.
Because they look so long. Yeah.
Either way, he is once again in an esteemed position where he's surrounded by beings who look up to him and are like, oh, you're so great. What a novelty. You are so interesting, sir.
Yeah. I also feel like he failed at his, you know, real grown-up job, which I can relate to having failed at a real grown-up job. But, you know, like he is returning to like his comfort space where he knows he's going to he'll get through the job, he'll do the day, and people will think he's doing great. Suddenly, isn't that bad, right?
Yeah, I liked it as like a bookend of like the whole story, but I do think it kind of like drives home a little bit maybe the lack of character or like the emotional lack of character growth. I think and just
it's the first time I thought I'd be happier if a character died. I think I would have appreciated it more.
This brings up one of our other questions. Lauren was, how does everybody feel about the ending?
It felt a little cornball to me. Like, don't get me wrong. I love a nice, corny, kind of heartfelt, like, and everyone had a great rest of their day. Like, I will absolutely get down with that. In this particular situation, I feel like the ending would have been more impactful if it was like, and there it is on Iridian, a gravestone with Ryland Grace's name written on it.
We tried to feed him. It was hard.
I would argue that instead of being corny, the ending is actually hella dark and creepy.
Really?
I would say that is mildly terrifying. He is now essentially on a pitch black planet in a bubble of light that he lives in. He can't go out. He's constantly visible to anyone on the planet, to anyone else on the planet. He is once again literally full of himself. He is eating his own.
That was pretty gross.
I thought that was hilarious.
And yet, this is perfect for this character because, like, that's all he wants. He just wants to be the center of attention. He wants everyone to see him as important. This is the perfect happy ending for him, and it is horrifying. So scary. Do not want. Yuck. Very bad.
I also thought it was like kind of eerie. I got like the cornball ending vibes with like the teaching the class and it comes full circle and bookends the story. But also like the description was very unsettling. Of like the darkness I was imagining like Sandy's like little dome from SpongeBob. Okay. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. My perfect ending, I think, would have been him deciding to go back to Earth and like face whatever it was he finds there. So as like, because I was like disappointed he didn't go.
That would have
just it felt like a, yeah, it felt like it would have been more meaningful for him to like face off, go back to like Earth and like own up to kind of what he's left behind. And he didn't, and I was like a little disappointed at that, but that's how I would have ended it. Not with a death, but with like him setting out on yet another journey, but intentionally this time.
I like how it was bleak and realistic. This is what humans do. But yes, that would be a very nice ending, Lauren, and would give a very good, like, actual, like, growth arc. Like, that would be something where you, and it would give you, like, oh, well, I wonder what's going to happen to him now. Like, is this going to pay out for him? Like, that would be a nice thing to wonder. But I think I so much enjoyed the reveal and the flip of the book that I'm like, yes, this ending, while being horrifying, is also perfect. Like, this is actually and like, it's a happy ending for Earth. It's a happy ending for Arid. It's a happy ending for the main character. And yet at the same time, horrifying, like very scary.
Yeah, I guess I hadn't really thought of the like spook atmosphere kind of piece of it. For me, I think it would be eerie, but I think for Ryland, I think it's basically perfect. Like, I don't.
Perfection. That's great.
It's paradise. It is hard for me to see it as a dark, horrifying ending when the character themselves don't see it that way. Like, I guess the perspective being from his viewpoint the whole time, if he is happy in that situation, which he clearly is, then like, who am I to say it's wrong for him to be eating burgers made of him?
He's like, perfectly fine with it.
He's fine with it. Yeah. Like,
it's auto cannibalism. Like, what am I going to say? That's illegal on alien planets? Like, come on. Like,
we might actually not be that far from doing that ourselves. It's just not us personally, but genetic material that would be created in meat and labs. I'd probably not eat it because I'm not that attached to meat, but I'd rather people ate that than factory farm. Anyway, that's a whole different topic. But
this is something I'm very interested in. I'm a vegan, and I have lots of opinions on meat consumption and cannibalism. But I would totally eat a farm grown piece of, I've never eaten meat before. I was raised vegetarian. Okay. But I would eat farm grown meat as long as, I guess, it was not produced with like animal testing and cruelty. Bring it on. I think I would eat people if it was ethically donated and like made in a lab.
I wouldn't argue with that, really. We're just putting bodies in the ground. Anyway, hello. So
I hate to be this person, but I'm pretty sure that technology already exists and is just getting up to like consumer production levels right now.
Yeah.
The future is now.
Yeah, I mean, hopefully one day it gets scalable enough to come under the greenhouse emissions for like factory farming.
Yeah.
So we'll see.
What other questions are on that list of questions, Sharon?
I have one. If Sharon.
Yes.
Yeah.
What did I write down? What did you think of Strat? And did she make the right call forcing Ryland onto the ship against his will. Oh, like what, you know, like the ethical question, like one person's life versus like the fate of humanity. I thought that was a really interesting chapter and a really cool glimpse at like her character, both when she has to decide between the coma and not the coma, and then also when she decides to force Ryland's hand.
My gut reaction is ethically wrong choice, but situationally correct choice. Like, she got it done. And I think that she knew well enough how he would react upon waking and like gradually figuring things out to make that call and be like, by the time he gets this figured out, he's already gonna be like trying to get in good with everyone. So he's not gonna wanna reveal this. He's going to want everyone to like him. So he's not going to say anything. He's going to try and do his best. And granted, his crewmates died. But this brings up another point. And I think Craig said something about it in the chat too. But like when he wakes up and he doesn't know who the people are, he doesn't have like any real feelings about it at all. It like he has to go through a whole bunch of like sort of memories to have even like a little bit of like caring about them. And then it's just, it feels very performative to a degree, almost like he's performing it just for himself, just so that he can tell himself that he's a good person, which he does multiple times throughout the book.
I don't think that's fair. I think he does care about them. I think it's, personally, I think it might just be Andy Weir's writing style that like isn't very emotional. Like it's hard to connect, I think, with the emotions of the character. So like, I think it's there. I mean, you know, like they're coworkers.
And the way he described them was kind of like they were mummified. So I kind of related to that. Like, it's like seeing something in a museum rather than like a real person. It's just, if you're already disoriented, especially, I could see it not being something you'd emotionally connect to. Like, that's a body. Very, very dead body.
I feel like the difference here, and I think kind of what Sharon's getting at, is that if I woke up on a spaceship and I saw two of my crewmates very clearly dead, I'd be like, oh my God, what happened? Like, who were these people? Like, why did this happen to them? Why did I get to live? Like, there's a little bit of that survivor's guilt that Ryland never really does, which is more standard humanity than not. And personally, my theory is that Andy Weir as a person is not tremendously in touch with his emotions. And so writing a super emotional reaction to something like that isn't something he's familiar with. And you don't write things you don't know.
Yeah.
I have wondered like how similar to Ryland Grace is Andy Weir. And like my theory on the end of the book, like, did he write the ending to be creepy, or am I just seeing it that way because I have such a distaste for this type of human? And I'm like, oh, that's perfect because it's creepy as hell. But maybe he thinks it's a perfect ending.
He does think it's a perfect ending. He's on the record. I was looking up the interview to see where it was they talked about the ending.
Well, I do agree that it's a perfect ending. But I think it's a perfect ending because it's terrifying.
I'm gonna have to watch this interview.
It's a written one. So I'm scanning through it right now. Let's see. he talks about the ending in there somewhere, because apparently he does read Goodreads reviews, because he was like, people in the Goodreads reviews were talking about how they didn't love the ending, and he was like, the ending. Hold on, let me do Control F. Ending.
Well, a better idea.
Here it is. I've seen this on Goodreads reviews, and a lot of people are like, I don't know about the ending. But about halfway through the book, I decided that was how it's going to end, even earlier than that. Actually, he doesn't really say why he thought he wanted to end it that way, now that I've read that.
Yeah, definitely post that interview in the book club chat again so that we can go over it as a group. Because I think there will be some interesting post-mortem diagnosis that all of us will be doing on Andy Weir as a person based on
this. I'm going to pop into the chat and... but he also talked about his own character a little bit in there. So yeah, it would just be helpful.
Regarding Strat, and like how much, first of all, best character in the book, hands down, not even a single question mark.
No, Rocky.
See, I loved Rocky, but no one will have my heart quite like Strat did.
I agree.
Particularly when she's saying things like, he's like, yeah, you're going to hell for this. And she's like, yeah, all of us are. That's the next 14 years. So thanks for doing your part. be still my beating heart. I was all about Strat. God, the question of whether or not she was morally correct to drug Ryland and shove him on a spaceship he didn't want to be on so that she could potentially save Earth. That's tough, but I think I'm gonna have to agree with Craig on this one. The needs of the many outweigh the needs of the few or the one, and if we are willing to keep people who are threats to other lives away from the general populace, because we're worried that they will continue to be threats to other lives, then I think we also have to be comfortable with the concept of making use of a life to save the many. But then, of course, we get into the gray area of like sacrificing people against their will, and that's really dark and nasty. And so, like, I don't want to get too deep into it because this is my like off the knee kind of impression of that. But like, I feel like were I in Strat's shoes, I would probably make the same call. Because it's the only way it's getting done. I can't count on someone to learn enough about the mission in the like 6 days or whatever they had to get it done. I need someone who knows what they're doing to get out there and get it done.
Yeah. Reading the scene, I was not like, oh no, Strat's being horrible here. I was like, Grace, get off your butt. It's okay to cry and feel bad about it. Why? Just give up. Like, even if you don't like it, like, there's not a better alternative. Like, yeah. you're going to be here. Like, just go. Either way, it's going to suck. Go suck in space.
Right? Like say you don't want to, and she's like, okay, well, you don't have a choice, and then accept it with some grace. Like, she has an army.
Yeah, the screaming and crying at a guard, really. I just felt bad, like, kind of ashamed. Like,
I think it was
not even mad at it, just like, ew, stop, come on.
Yeah.
There are pages where she, like, is calling him out and is like, why the hell did you think you were here?
Like, what do you think I kept a junior high school science teacher around so long?
I was just like, yes! Yes! Thank God. And yes, simultaneously just fell in love with her and was like, what a smart lady. Oh, yeah. She had it, you know, the whole time. She just had her cards. There they were. Yep. So good. Also, I was taking notes as I was reading, and I got to that page and I wrote LOL. So I'm just like, yeah.
Not ethically conflicted about.
Yeah. Oh, and the other part where he's remembering when like his coworkers are like, oh, we thought y'all were like together. Like, cause why else would you be here? I was just like, yes. Yeah. Sorry. That was just the heart goer patter. So good.
Yeah. I really enjoyed her character. I think on paper, maybe the wrong choice, but I think with the extraordinary circumstances, the right one. I enjoyed that like kind of like ethical question. I think that like I like when sci-fi asks, you know, some of those sort of philosophical questions. My favorite Strat moment, I think, was the little vignette of the copyright like trial. And because it was so frivolous, it's like, really? You're doing a copyright strike on like the person who's like trying to save humanity? And I'm like, that would totally happen. 100%. Yeah. They would be like, where's my money? You can't have Adobe Illustrator.
And, right.
And like she like just strolls in there like, this is a courtesy. Like, it was...
I did enjoy that a little too much. Yeah.
She just walked in and was like, you're welcome.
Military with her. Yeah.
It was great. And, it was a nice little bit of world building, too. And I think a little skewer on, like, you know, American capitalism. So
I did enjoy the weird twist on a typical patriotic statement where she's like, if you're going to come after me, you're going to have one hell of an army, because I have the U.S. Army and that's one hell of an army. And it's like, America. Oh, wait. So good. So good. Yeah, easily. Hands over. Hands down favorite character in the entire book. Like, she made a lot of really dreadful decisions that were really awful, but when your back's against the wall, you do what you gotta do.
I mean, it's kind narrow focus. Like, if you have one thing you have to do, then you're gonna, it's just like, okay, does this do that thing? Nope, bye. Does this do that thing? Yes, go. Must be very nice.
I would love some bonus short stories about Strat. I think that would be a nice little extra.
We gotta
brush up on our little fan fiction writing skills. Fix that ending. Get some short stories.
Yeah. Gosh, I'd like to. I might write some Strat fanfic. That'd be kind of fun. Did you look up Rocky fan art? There's some really cute Rocky fan art.
Oh, I didn't. But
I didn't even think to do that.
Share it on the Discord.
I will definitely. Yeah.
Please.
People have some very adorable things. All right. Can I suggest that we go down a slight rabbit hole of things that annoyed you and that weren't answered? like, why did they send somebody to collect information from another solar system, but not give him a way to send back physical samples? It could only be data sent back. Like, you would think it might be a physical situation, right?
I have a great answer for this, and this is because I work with a lot of really smart people. Really, really smart people who are really, really good at what they do are incredibly stupid at practical things. Like,
so you're like, this is totally realistic. This would happen.
Oh, absolutely. Like, scientists being like, okay, we've done it. We've designed the perfect interstellar travel device that has a large database for data storage within it so that you can send them. And we've got multiple copies so that it's perfected, so that you can get anything back to us that you need to. And then I guarantee it was like 2 weeks after the ship left, somebody was like, what if he needs to send back a sample of something? And everybody's like, no. Oh,
yes.
Yeah. At my job, we've been talking a lot about generalists versus specialists. And so that's a thing that, you know, like Strat, like, I think that they talk to her about like, what's her background. And it was something random, like history or political science or something.
Yeah.
And
or art history, like, something like that. Yeah.
Yeah. I can't remember specifically what it was.
It was random, though. Like, yeah.
It wasn't science. And she had to just like project manage the hell out of everything and know enough about enough different things to make the pieces fit together. And I was like, this is beautiful. So good. So she was like a specialist in general, in generalizing. She was a generalist special. I was just like, this is beautiful. This is so good. Because she just amassed her armies of specialists and like just shot them out to do what they needed to do and deployed them very efficiently and like had backup plan on backup plan. Oh, so good. Yeah. So she made sure that even though the specialists would have that oversight, at least there were some backups that some other team was working on. So that's why all of the astrophage went to so many different places and had like that part. It was like, that was where the science part started making sense. I was like, why in the world does he have this guy looking at stuff? And I was like, well, he kind of doesn't matter. So if he dies, you know, it's fine. But now that we know what's going on, because he stumbled into the correct answer, how convenient for us, we will now give it to the real scientists. And sure, why not let him have a few?
Sorry, I'm squinting at the chat. So first time chat, hello, welcome. The cheese stands apart. They did give him the ability to send samples back. They gave him a pretty good 3D printer that he could use to fabricate anything he might need. So would that be good enough to send back a predator?
Without the use of Rocky's advanced technology, I don't see you 3D printing something onto a ship that's supposed to go near light speed, unless you are a master fabricator, which I will point out, nobody on the ship was.
Yeah, nobody besides Rocky would have been able to do anything close to that.
I do think it was an oversight. I think like the thinking from the team was, they have a lab on site. They'll do all of the analysis that they could ever need to do, like right there. But I do think like,
they never thought it would be a predator that they might find.
I mean, they should, like, it makes sense though. If there's one,
yeah,
you know, alien, there might be another.
I think the assumption was that it would be a chemical fix that they could fabricate back on Earth. And not a biological fix, because what are the odds of two interstellar traveling organisms that happen to interact with each other? There's no way that could happen.
That'll never happen.
I mean, it seems like such a low tech answer, I guess.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, what did, you know, the British and Australia do? Like, oh, we've got all these, you know, toads. Let loose the marmoset. Oh no, now we have all these marmosets. Like, owls. People have been doing that since like the 1800s.
Right.
Yeah.
It always goes well too. So.
But like not that different.
Yeah, I really do. I think it's just a situation where the scientists could not see the forest because there was too many trees in the way. Like
yeah, that makes sense.
Little plot. All right,
well, that was just one of my annoying questions. I have another annoying question, but if there are any like book club literary type questions too, I don't want to step over those. About characterizations. Okay, I asked this one in chat, but how did Iridian study astrophage? Because they didn't have microscopes and they can't see molecular level. Apparently.
So they don't have microscopes, but they are aware of base elements and their chemical compositions. I think the difference is they wouldn't use a microscope because they're not vision based. They right. would use something like a microwave.
But he wasn't able to analyze anything from his ship. Well,
keep in mind that Rocky
was the
least scientifically apt of his entire crew, and he just so happened to survive because he was sleeping in the engine compartment.
Oh, that's true. Like, so there probably was somebody who knew how to do it, just not him.
Right. Well, and the whole time Grace is talking about, like, oh, I'll send you back with a computer. Like, here's how it works, and here's all the functions. And Rocky's like, no. I don't need to know all that stuff. My scientists will figure all of that out. I just need to know how to fix it if it breaks, and generally how to operate it, and that's it.
True.
So I think.
I was just going to say.
I just think that's the situation.
Yeah, they talk about like whether like Ryland wonders at some point whether Rocky is a genius or just some random Iridian. It was like on page 310 or something when Rocky was like building something that was very impressive, and he's just like, is this normal? Which I thought was like also a very funny question, considering like Ryland is a very unimpressive, just like he's just a nerdy guy who's very full of himself and has a lot of confidence, so he just does whatever he wants and is like, the hell with the consequences, I'm doing science.
I mean,
very relatable.
Lauren, what did you say?
I mean, he does have his like PhD in like astrobiology and has like an academia background, but like I get what you're saying. He's not like your top tier.
He can't handle peer review.
He's so sensitive.
Some of my favorite Grace and Rocky moments were where like Rocky is like, no, you do math really slow, so we always use Earth units. We never use my units. We always use your units because you do math so slow.
Pure comedy. Yes.
I feel like I've talked about like the emotional impact a couple of times. And I think the most like convincing emotional moments that we get from Ryland are like with Rocky, like when he's like waiting on Rocky to like wake up after the fire thing. Also, he thought he could go in and like fix it, and he like totally makes it worse.
Yeah.
As Rocky states on page 210, you are bad.
But that's like, you know, I didn't find a lot of like emotional like authenticity from him as a character, but I think the scenes with Rocky is when it like really shines. Like you feel, I think, their connection more than you feel his connection to anyone on Earth or the mission or saving the planet. Like none of that. I think it's, you know, when he's like all scared, like kind of scared and alone out in the middle of nowhere.
Yeah, and it might have been his first real friend. Like, we don't see him have any other real friends. He had lunch with some people. You know, he has coworkers, but he doesn't really have any connections. Like, the only real connection. And he says he bonded with the crew, but he didn't really bond with the crew. You know, they were on a separate thing. He just happened to be put on that ship with them.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I think Rocky might have been his first friend, period.
I will say that they are friends. But I also think that a lot of his decisions, while maybe partially based in friendship, are also still based in a little bit of ego, a little bit of fear of being alone because of ego. And like you can see that when he sort of disrespects Rocky's request to watch him sleep. He's like, I'm gonna bounce. I'm not going to sit here and watch you sleep. I'm going to go do other stuff. He doesn't actually stay.
Eventually he stayed, but yeah.
he wasn't an anthropologist. No, no sensitivity there at first.
I think
Lachie stands apart and says, I did also wonder about the psychology aspect of things. They had to put humans in a coma because the risk of the crew killing themselves en route was too high. But at the end of the book, Ryland was able to tolerate probably 4 subjective years of daily life in an even more cramped ship with an alien without them killing each other. And I mean, they couldn't kill each other as part of
that. They were in their own little sandy tube thing from SpongeBob. The little their habit own trail. I love that concept. I'd love to see some fan art of it.
I'm like ready to see that movie. I'm ready. I want to see it.
With the little like hamster habit trail.
I really wonder how they're going to play his character in the movie. Like, is he going to be a guru, or is he going to be an unreliable narrator, not a hero? Where he is.
And when you're talking about the ending earlier. Yeah. When you were talking about the ending earlier, I was thinking, gosh, yeah, the movie, that would be extra hard. Like, the ending of The Martian is just obviously like, you've come from space to the beautiful Earth, and look, things are growing from the ground. It's wonderful. Like, the ending of this would be totally the opposite. It'd be like, so you went from space to a dome in a dark planet. It'd be visually, yeah, hard to do in a movie for sure.
They'll put some inspiring music on it. They'll make the alien kids real cute. Like, no problem.
Oh my God, the little kids are so cute by Steven Spielberg. Yeah.
Yeah, will he be eating me burgers? Which is what he calls them because he's disgusting.
I think that's Lost Lamy's comment that Rocky's ship is significantly larger than the Hail Mary. That is something I totally forgot about, but super true.
Did he travel back on the on that ship then? Did Rocky make a way for him to be on that? Okay.
Rocky moved to a significantly smaller ship because they take the Hail Mary to Arid.
Okay, that's what I thought.
I thought they took...
I only remember that because part of the ending commentary is that they had refueled the Hail Mary ages ago, and it was just a question of if and when Ryland wanted to leave.
Yeah, and the Taumiba had infiltrated the structure was made out of. So that's why Rocky was like sort of dead in the water there.
Xenonite. Oh, Xenonite. It's driving me crazy. This whole call. Like,
the stuff that's not supposed to be solid science.
The noble ignoble gas.
Craig, you're so funny. Hans Zimmer's warming up the
I think like Rocky absolutely is Ryland's greatest friend of all time. I don't know if it's like only friend situation, but definitely this is a situation where Ryland is in desperate need of companionship because he's been traveling for weeks alone. He's in desperate need of a skill set that he doesn't possess, and Rocky has that in spades. And then Rocky, in turn, is constantly like, oh, your science stuff, it's so good. So, like, it's precisely the sort of ego stroking that Ryland would want out of a relationship to begin with. So I think it ends up working out precisely like it would need to for the two of them to just be, like, a super tight.
And then Ryland gets to live out the rest of his days being what a smart alien. The special, special smart alien that lives on this planet. I did really like just like the little bits that you hear about the Iridian like civilization. Mm-hmm. Like I thought where they were talking about how they like come together to make decisions and they call it a thrum. I was like, that's great. They like come together and just like make a harmonious or make a sound until it like they all agree and it becomes a harmonious sort of situation. I'm just like, that's nice. I like it so much.
Very cool.
Like, I loved every aspect of this book. I hated the character. Loved the way that it ended. So perfect. Everything 100% perfect.
I'll agree with you. I thought the Iridians, I kind of judge like sci-fi alien creation. I'm like, is this just copy paste humanity? Because that's less interesting. And I felt like the Iridians were like unique and interesting, both like physiologically and like culturally. I felt it was very satisfying to get like those like little bits and pieces. And I forgot I ordered the book, and my partner had it on audiobook, and I listened to it, which was fantastic because all of the Iridian like tones are done in the first off, best audiobook I've ever listened to. Best.
Oh, wow.
And the like musical aspects of the Iridians are like translates really well into audiobook.
Cool. So how did they do that? Was it like Rocky's speech or
like in the Rocky when it's like his speech is in like those like the mm-hmm. tones, those are just tones. But Rocky's like speech is like different, like sounds different. It's a little, I don't know, like it went through like a little voice changer.
Like a vocoder maybe?
Yeah. It's been a month since I listened to it, but it was very good.
That is worth keeping in mind. All right. Let's do final thoughts on the book or maybe like favorite quotes. I have a favorite quote, something that Strat says, which we never really covered tonight. But there's a point where Rylan's like, hey, you can't just be a dick to people because you have all this authority. And she's like, yeah, I just hate dictators and their little corners of power. Like, I was like, you know what? Me too, actually. I also hate those people. Where they're like, no, we're doing things my way because this is my space. Like, ah.
Yeah. I also, my closing thought is I really enjoyed it. Frustrating elements for sure, but I think a very enjoyable read. I don't have a quote, but one of the pieces that we didn't talk about that I really enjoyed was Strat talking about her power again and how it's all temporary because once she pulls this off, the resentment from the world's like governments and people are gonna blow back on her. And so like, she is very intentionally making this self-sacrificing choice that like Ryland did not. And it's really interesting that she's like aware of it. I don't know. I thought it added like a really interesting layer of complexity to her character that I just liked her so much.
Fully agreed.
Basically the entirety of page 392, which is Strat just like shredding him to bits. She tells him, you know, like if he really cared about the children, that he would get on that ship without hesitation. He's a coward and he always has been. He abandoned a promising scientific career because people didn't like a paper that he wrote. You retreated to the safety of children who worship you for being the cool teacher. You don't have a romantic partner in your life because that would mean you might suffer heartbreak. You avoid risk like the plague.
Get him, Strat.
Do it. Just read him.
Get him.
She's like, I don't care who wants to go. I care who's most qualified. And unfortunately, that's him.
Damn.
Yep.
All right, I'll go next. I did really enjoy it. And I'm going to end on a positive note because it's a quote that I posted in chat pretty early on, and it still makes me smile. And when I had pretty fond feelings about the narration, it's from page 180. I have to assume friendly intent at this point. I mean, they're going out of their way to say hi and be accommodating. Besides, if there is hostile intent, what would I do about it? Die. That's what I do. I'm a scientist, not Buck Rogers. I liked that. I just die. Now you're okay with dying. Cool. But I didn't think about that then. But that's retroactively. But I just really enjoyed that.
It is one of the few times that Ryland Grace is self-effacing. Where it's like, I can't fight aliens.
He's a little self-effacing a lot, though. As like a, I'm so likable. Right? Ha! Huh. Thing. Which is part of the reason why I was like, this guy drives me nuts.
Sharon, did you read The Martian?
I haven't.
Okay, you might really hate that then, because that's like his total character, really.
So stay away from The Martian is what I'm hearing for Sharon. All right, let's talk a little bit briefly. Sharon, you got the winning votes for this coming month's book, The Binti Trilogy, a series of three novellas wrapped up into one tidy collection. What do you know about the story? What can you tell us? Why should we be excited? So excited.
I heard it recommended on a podcast and I bought it like last year. It's just been on the shelf waiting for me. It has a really cool cover. I don't know where it is right now. I would go find it if I did. I don't know. It sounded like a good time. So I hope that it is.
I saw part of the synopsis is she's like under attack on her ship. And so it's like, I've got to survive this situation because I've got to go. It's like a peace treaty negotiation or something that she said it to. Like, it sounds intense. I'm excited for a little political intrigue, a little more sci-fi, space thriller action. Maybe someone who's a little more heroic than Ryland Grace.
I think it'll be a nice contrast. I've read the first of the novellas.
Oh, perfect.
I'm excited to read, because I've been meaning to read the other two. So this will be good. I'm looking forward to it.
Craig says, read the first two novellas separate, and the main character is wonderful. So
nice.
We have all of that to look forward to. I'm excited. Okay, see, I can get on board with that, but we'll have to see for ourselves. Do we have book suggestions for the upcoming poll?
Yes.
Because I was trying desperately to think of things I would throw into the hat, and I'm coming up a little bit shorthanded for a change.
I'll go because I only have one suggestion, and I know Lauren has a few. I don't know what Sharon has, but I literally just looked up earlier, like, best fantasy novels on Goodreads, and The Witch's Heart was one that came up, and it sounded really interesting. When a banished witch falls in love with the legendary trickster Loki, she risks the wrath of the gods in this moving, subversive debut novel that reimagines Norse mythology. So it's basically like a witch's story, feminist version of Norse mythology. So that sounded something like I thought we might enjoy.
Yeah. I like the, there's been like a number of like feminist retellings of mythology in the past like 5 years, and I've really been enjoying the trend.
Yeah, I really like the Circe, mm-hmm. Just in that.
That's what
somebody compared this to that. Yeah, favorably. Yeah.
Sweet. I've got it on the list.
Okay.
Lauren, you said you had some delectable suggestions for us.
Yes, I have. I think I haven't recommended. I have two new recommendations.
Ooh.
Both are on. Were on the Hugo nominees for this year. So the first is Light from Uncommon Stars. And I haven't read it, so I'll just read the description a little bit. Shizuku Satomi made a deal with the devil. To escape damnation, she must entice seven other violin prodigies to trade their souls for success. She's already delivered six. When Katrina, a young transgender runaway, catches Shizuku's ear with her wild talent, Shizuku can almost feel the curse lifting. She's found her final candidate. And then she meets a starship captain, and there's like some interstellar romance. So it looks to be sort of like a sci-fi fantasy. What do you call that? A space fantasy? And then the other one is She Who Became the Sun. I actually have that right here. It's pitched as Mulan meets the Song of Achilles, an accomplished poetic debut of war and destiny sweeping across an epic alternate China. And I think it's like pretty like gritty and feminist, and it's low on the fantasy, high on like the alternate history war. I think there is magic in it, but it kind of plays like a simmer role than like a center, like wizards kind of a role.
Right.
So
low magic.
Low magic,
but low magic.
And also on my list is Master of Djinn, which I think I've recommended before, so I don't need to recommend it again. But it is.
Yeah, I at some point we're going to have enough suggestions that haven't been picked that we're really excited about. We're going to have to just do like, we're just voting on things we've picked previously this year, this month, like that sort of thing. Because there's some books that we have suggested before that I've been like, oh, but I want to read that. I am going to throw in one that's been suggested a couple of times by one of our book club members. It's called Kings of the Wild. And it is a fantasy story which is about a retired band of mercenaries that come out of retirement to save one of their members' daughter.
That sounds very D&D.
That one. It's like an irreverent, like, kind of tropey fantasy.
Hmm. Yeah, I think it's supposed to be a little bit of like cheeky fantasy.
Yeah,
which I am very much about as a longtime fan of the Myth series by Robert Asprin. Marl, have you been trapped in here too long? She. I think she heard Alex moving around out of the room and is like, "Well, I would like to be out there. I'm tired of being in here trapped with you." I'm not as exciting, clearly. You will be free soon. You'll be free so soon. I promise. I do.
Mochi does that at 6:30 in the morning when everybody wakes up. I want to see where the people are. I want to see.
Okay, so we've got five great suggestions. I'm going to say we can throw one from chat in there. But while folks are maybe typing up their suggestions into chat, what do we have to plug tonight? Marian, since you are our esteemed guest, let's start with you. What would you like to plug?
This is always hard because this is a book that I really wrote under a pen name because I was like, oh, look, nobody will ever have to know that I wrote it, but I'm working on a sequel to it now. So I should probably try to promote books if I'm going to self-publish. So I wrote this book a few years ago. It's probably more of a novella, really. It's kind of short. It's a romantic fantasy that wrangles with mortality and how do you make human connections if you know that people are going to die? Because I was going through some stuff. But, you know, I'm still going through some stuff because that's life and death. So I'll drop the chat link in. And it's called With Death in Autumn. And my pen name is Sonia Bassetti. I do have a Twitter account. I don't really talk about writing and such on there, but it's at Marianne Clapp, just like I have on here. I keep Wordle on there and random retweets. And I also have a secret BTS stan account if anybody wants to follow that. But you have to DM me for that information. And my fanfic. That's on the down low. I'm not putting it on Twitch.
Fair. Lauren, what would you like to plug tonight?
I guess the same thing. I'm going to come up with a different thing to plug next time. If you want, you can follow me on Instagram at Feminist Reading List, where I talk about and review books that I'm reading, sci-fi, fantasy, romance, manga. I've been really into these like Chinese fantasy novels lately, so you can hear me talk way too much about that.
I'm excited about She Who Became the, like, honestly, all of these, I'm feeling good about whoever wins right now, because these all sound delightful. Sharon, what do you have for us tonight?
Oh, you know, I never know what I'm going to say here. let's see, we've got OPDs, we got podcasts, we got a website, we got a Twitter account. I don't know. Josh, take it home.
let's see. The Twitter account is at Goblins Growlers. We've got the Patreon, which is patreon.com/goblinsgrowlers. We've got the Discord. If you're not already on the Discord, get on there, bit.ly/goblindiscord. We always have conversation threads for the books that we're currently reading, so that as you start getting to parts that you're like, someone talk to me about this stuff, like Marianne, I think you were the one who really jumped in there and spurred a lot of the conversation for Project Hail Mary, where it was like, oh my God, someone please come talk to me about Rocky. So yes, if you're not already in there, get in there so that we can all talk about these things together.
Talking and writing is so much easier, really. I like your face.
Thank you. I am going to throw out for kind of a community plug, the RVA Safe Space Market, which is a farmer's market, which is open every Saturday from 9 a.m. to 12 p.m. in Lakeside, Virginia. You can look it up. It's Safe Space Market. That's by RACAB RVA, and they have a ton of really cool vendors. They support a lot of local charities that are really cool, that do things like support LGBTQ rights. And yeah, go check it out if you're in the RVA area. And if you're not in the RVA area, then reach out to people in the RVA area and convince them to ship things to you. It's 100% a thing that our community will do without question. I see a suggestion from Craig for a book called Meddling Kids by Edgar Quintero, which was recommended on a podcast as Scooby-Doo Meets the Cthulhu Mythos. So I'm going to throw that on the list. And we have our entire poll. As of ending book club call, we have our whole poll. What a rarity. Perfect. I've got it all recorded. I'll get that poll up soon.
Can I jump in real quick about that book that Craig mentioned?
Yeah.
There's a question, is this book diverse? And I think it's the author who answers, or somebody answers actually. It stars a dog, a ghost, multiple people struggling with severe mental illness, and a host of various creatures. It sounds pretty diverse.
I think that'd be pretty fun. Yeah. I am totally cool with putting that on the list of options. All right. I think unless anybody's got anything specific that we want to jump into right here at the tail end, I think we should wrap it up. And I'm excited to get into the Binti trilogy and see what's going on in other parts of outer space.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you for coming on.
Joining.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, as always, to Sharon and Lauren, my wonderful co-hosts. And thank you to everyone who tuned in and has been engaging in chat. The chat has been a little livelier tonight than it sometimes is. I love to see it. And we will be back now that we have an official date for all of these, being the last Tuesday of every month. We will be back on the 31st of May, May 31 at 7 p.m. So I'm looking forward to reading the Binti trilogy, and then I'll be on Discord talking about thoughts and opinions and speculations and theories as we progress through the book. Thank you all so much for joining, and we'll see you next month. Bye.
Bye.